Hello YouTube. Right in the middle of doing some cutting. Got delayed by weather and some other things, but yeah. This is why pickup trucks are great, because you can turn the back of it into a impromptu workbench. Like in this case, I've been using my chop saw and set up a roller stand, running my lengths, just pulling them through. Here's the piles of lumber that is cut. I'm almost done. This stack is actually done. I'm building a workbench for a friend of mine as kind of a belated Christmas present, based roughly off the design of my big one. And this is the lumber that is going to make up the hauling rack that will go over there. Boy, bright. Go over there in the pickup truck. I've still got, I don't know, about 5 or 6 more pieces to cut. But my stack of lumber, all this salvaged lumber that I had mentioned in previous videos, which I rescued, this is all reclaimed. My stack is slowly getting used up for useful projects, so that's awesome. And it has cost me nothing other than time, and I'm enjoying myself, so I can't really count that. One of the things I wanted to point out, though, here's a piece. This is one of the older pieces that came out of the shed that I had reclaimed. A friend of mine had in his backyard and got permission from his landlord to tear it down. And the floor was gone, the foundation, the cement block foundation was crumbling, but there was a lot of good timber still in the framing of it, in the roof and in the walls. So I rescued what I could and pulled out most of the nails. This is really old. This is probably 30 or 35 year old yellow pine. Very different than the pine you get now. This is unbelievably heavy and hard and dense wood. Very, very strong compared to some of the newer stuff. Some of the lighter colored wood down there is wood that I've scavenged from construction sites and stuff that were offcuts or pieces that they rejected because they had bark on them or whatnot. But anyway, this is what I wanted to show you. I sure hope this shows up. Right here. And here's a couple good examples. These are staples. And that's one of the things you've got to be careful about in if you start using reclaimed lumber or dumpster lumber or whatnot. There were staples in these. One of the pieces over there on the pile, I had found a nail still partially embedded in it. So you kind of have to work around that and cut around it. I tried to pull most of the nails out. You can see nail holes here. This is where siding was nailed onto the shed, I think. I got most of that out, but every so often you'll find one. So you gotta look over reclaimed lumber pretty carefully, because if you run that through your chop saw and you catch a staple, the blade will probably be okay. If you catch like a 10-penny nail, you're gonna screw up your blade in either your chop saw or your table saw. You run something like this through a jointer and it's sayonara for the knives. You'll not just nick them, you'll take chunks out. So you'll be buying a new set of knives for your jointer. So yeah, use caution when using this stuff. But I'm sorry I'm not getting enough video of the process of it, but it's really actually kind of boring just cutting these stacks of lumber over there. I'm just cutting them to length. These are not finished length. I'm cutting them a little bit long, and because I'm going to have to true up, not every edge, since these are rough lumber projects, but true up a few edges and kind of test fit everything together, and then I'll cut them to final length when I get ready to do the assembly. But yeah, I wanted to make a note about that and give you some idea of the progress, and I'll shoot some more video once I get to the point where I can start assembling some of this stuff. So yeah, I'll be back later. Okay, I was a little dense with that. What I wanted to, I forgot to show you. For getting out stuff like staples, anything that's in the surface is really easy. You can usually get a flathead screwdriver. Use an older beat-up screwdriver, but you can just get under those and dig down in the wood a little bit here. Let's see if I can show you. If you can get a corner of the screwdriver under it, it'll normally, you can work it out here. See if I can get another one of these out. Yeah, this one's coming up. There we go. Yeah. Another thing you can do is if you have a pair of diagonal cutters like this, use an older pair that's seen some miles and maybe doesn't cut as well. But you can get a better grip with these than you can with like needle nose pliers or something. And you can actually bite down in the wood. And if you get on either side, bite down a little and then twist. You can normally get a blade up under them. These are being hard. It's hard to do this with one hand. I need to hold the piece of wood. But you get the idea. Screwdriver and a pair of diagonal cutters, and you can dig and pry most of these kind of staples out. For nails, you can use, if you can't get them out, you can use the diagonal cutters to try to get a hold of them. But the best thing, look in the toolbox here, where are they? Right here. It's a pair of edge nippers. Right? These allow you to get right down on the surface. So if you can dig around a nail hole with a screwdriver, and then all you gotta do is get a bite and then pinch the crap out of it and then rock them. Start rocking them out. And if you get a good enough bite on it, you'll be able to rock it and start pulling it out, grab a new grip, and you can work them out. But yeah, I gotta get back to work.
Hey,
so more
back
later.
Out in the garage. Progress continues on the wood projects. What I've got right here using my table saw as a flat surface is the top, I guess you could call it the rail and style or support frame of the workbench that I'm building for my friend. What I did is these cross pieces and the long stringers all the way down, I ran through the jointer to put a nice straight clean top edge on them. And that way, then I flipped them over and I assembled it essentially upside down. So the MDF surface will be attached to this side. The reason I'm doing that is right now the table saw is the flattest surface that was available in the workshop. I could have used my workbench, but again, projects just threw up all over it. I never did get a chance to clean it. I was doing my garage floor threshold install earlier. So the table saw was handy and I went ahead and did it. And you can see I've got clamps on it periodically because I'm using rough 2x4s. That's one of the fun things with rough lumber. It's cupped, it's bowed, it's dog-legged a little bit. I picked the straightest pieces I could find out of my pile for the top long rails, okay? For each of the, I think these are 66 inches long. You can cut shorter sections out of the stuff that's really more cupped or warped or whatever to make stringers like this, because it, again, I jointed the one edge so that I'd have a true edge and then flush fit it when I put this together. And it's just carpenter's glue, yellow glue, and drywall screws is what I'm using because I had a whole big box of them. And that's gonna dry overnight. I've also got the leg assemblies together here. This is the same layout that I have on my bench. It's just, instead of six legs, this is gonna have four. But there's a 10-inch section, a 24-inch section, and a 34-inch section. So essentially you create sort of a poor man's dado here and a poor man's rabbit. And the bottom shelf will fit on the inside here, and the top shelf will fit around the outside on the rabbit. So the top surface support stringers, like on my bench, will be in fact wider. So you can see through the crap, the top is in fact wider than the bottom one. And that's by design because you need more top surface. I could have put them both on the inside or the outside, but I chose not to. And the reason I did that was the bottom shelf will rest. There's gonna be some carriage bolts bolting these to the equivalent frame, lattice frame for the bottom shelf. But the weight of that shelf will rest directly on the 2x4. So the bolt won't really do anything except hold the leg to the shelf frame. All the weight will transfer through the 2x4, the 10-inch 2x4, directly to the floor. And the same thing goes for the top
this top rail assembly that's the glue is drying on, it will fit here, and I've got a single piece of 2x4 that connects it to the ground. So all of the weight, anything you put up, you know, you put a car engine on that workbench, all the weight will transfer directly from this frame to this 2x4 to the ground. So you're not dependent on a glue joint, you're not dependent on a screw or, you know, multiple screws or anything like that. But yeah, I got all four legs completed. These are the lateral pieces. You can see they're shorter. These are gonna go in the bottom shelf lattice or support frame. I've just got them on here now to help hold this flat to the table and keep everything true. I've got a bunch of clamps on the frame itself, in addition to the screws, to try to hold everything as tightly as possible until the glue finishes curing. That's just to keep it from warping. You want that top surface to be as straight as possible. And then as the light was failing outside, I went ahead and did my garage door. There'll be, you will have already seen, I'm filming this the same day, but you will have already seen the video on the garage door, and you'll know the results by now. Because I don't. This is still
curing. That's where things are.
I should be able to get the other frame built and glued and clamped tomorrow for the bottom shelf. And I will also go ahead and I've got to cut some uprights for him so that he can have a hanging rack like that on his. I haven't quite figured out what I'm going to do. I used a 2x8 as a backer board on mine. I don't have any more of that, and I'm trying to do this as a gift without spending very much money at all. So I'm probably going to end up rigging up some other kind of backer board off of the uprights for the hanger board. But I'll think about that tonight. I'll sketch up some ideas and see what I can come up with. But yeah, that's where things are so far, and I'm really getting excited because I'll be able to have this bolted together, probably not tomorrow, but day after tomorrow, which means I'll be able to take it over to him on Saturday and say, here you go, bud. Merry Christmas. A little bit late, but still. So, back later. Okay, everybody. This is just a little boo-boo video. Bloopers, I guess you would call it. I experimented when I was working on the upper shelf support or upper surface support lattice framework there, still drying. I was gonna try recessing them originally. I did not do that on my bench. If you look up under there, it's gonna be way too dark, but they're just butt joints with a lot of glue, some heavy screws. But I thought when I was building this for my friend, I'd experiment because I've seen different YouTube channels where you can cut dados and rabbits with a circular saw, and I wanted to experiment with it. And I thought, oh, well, you know, that looks like it worked pretty good. Well, one of the problems I ran into is there's a trick where you take a speed square, and when you want to do a cut across something, you know, you slap on the speed square, and then the shoe of your your circular saw runs along this edge, and if you hold this tight to the board and then run your saw across, you're supposedly going to get a nice clean edge. Well, it was kind of working, but it was hard to do with one hand. Everybody I watched on YouTube, you know, just zip 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 zip, you can see one in progress that I was doing here, and you cut either side and then you just sort of hog out the middle by making multiple cuts until this all the wood you can either knock out with a hammer or just keep making cuts. And then once it's mostly gone, you can run your saw side to side and sort of machine that smooth, mostly smooth. But I was having all kinds of problems. It slipped. I was cutting them too big. There's like all kinds of slop. I wanted to go ahead and try it because it was a technique I thought would be useful. And so I got one board done, and I wasn't happy with it, and there's just, you put a 2x4 in here, and it's all kinds of slop in that one. The end ones weren't too bad, but then I boogered up this one, and because I was working so hard to try to push the circular saw past, it was catching, and I couldn't figure out what it was catching on. It caused my hand to slip, and so the little speed square I was using slipped down, and so I cut the wrong line. And I was trying to figure out what the hell, what was going on? Why was this so difficult? Why couldn't I just go, you know, just grab the saw and go zing, 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 past? Well, it dawned on me after I'd ruined the two boards. I had never put anything on the bottom of the shoe to make it easy to use and make it slide. And I don't know if this will show up, but you can see a little bit of residue here. This is stupidity on my part. I had it. Beeswax. Go to your home center and pick up. I got this. This happens to be an ancient stick that I bought years ago. Oldham Cuddy's stick lubricant, right? It's basically just beeswax. Since then, I found there's a cheaper way to get a lot of beeswax. The formulation, this is a pretty hard formulation. I mean, I'm squeezing it and it's not squishing. But get a stick of this. I just rubbed it all over the saw, and just like putting wax on the bottom of your sled as a kid in the snow, holy cow, after that I was just zip, 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 zip. The saw was much easier to control. The shoe wasn't catching on the surface of the board. And I probably could have actually recessed the cuts the way I wanted to and had those cross pieces recess into the dados and into the rabbit the way I wanted. But I'd already boogered up two boards. It was getting late. I wanted to get them glued together. I knew that the butt joints would be strong enough with the screws supporting it. But yeah, that's a dummy move on my part. I may actually try this again using the circular saw on another project. For the most part, though, I think I'm going to confine all of my clever dado and rabbit cutting to the table saw and the miter gauge because it's a little bit easier to control. But yeah, heads up, get some beeswax. Oh, and the alternate source. If you need a source of beeswax to like coat, and I really do need to coat the surface of my jointer and the surface of my table after I clean and polish the surface of the table saw. But yeah, after they're cleaned and polished with some Scotch-Brite pads and that, I'm going to put beeswax on, but I'm not going to use that stick wax. Go to your home center and get a wax toilet gasket. Those toilet gaskets are just a few dollars, and they're nothing more than beeswax on a hunk of vinyl that you use to squish and create a seal when you install a toilet. So yeah, go get one of those, and I'm going to go get one and just use that and a rag, and then, like I said, after I get that clean and get some of the surface rust off, I'm just going to buff the bejeebers out of it. And I need to do the DeWalt chop saw too. But okay, good morning YouTube, and welcome back to the shop. You'll note that I no longer have stuff piled all over my table saw. I was using it as an assembly table. That's why one of my very next projects has got to be building an assembly table. Is this. This is Ross's workbench with some tools and stuff thrown in, but I've got all the pieces cut and done. We are headed over to his place in just a few minutes, and got a couple more bolt holes to drill. I'm going to let him do that and help me assemble it, and we will go from there. But there's some joinery mistakes. I'm still learning and getting the hang of things. Hi everybody, welcome back. Unfortunately, the last portion of this is going to have to be me narrating over a couple of photographs. On the day of delivery, I didn't have the time or opportunity to shoot very much video. My friend Ross was juggling his two kids, his wife was sick, so our hands were just full. And this is an incredibly sturdy bench. Compared to some of the stuff I've seen for sale on Craigslist, this thing is just a beast in terms of strength. But Let's go on here. Let me scroll this a little bit. So it's in the back of the truck, and I get to my friend's house, and here it is. Let me just shrink this. And we started out by putting in diagonally opposite legs, and you'll see why in a minute. But you see the sawdust down there in the corner. That is from drilling the pilot hole and then the final 3/8 inch hole for the
bolt that holds the leg to the top surface. This whole thing is essentially assembled upside down. But we clamp the legs on, and the reason for clamping those on are so that we can then pivot in the support framework bottom shelf. Rather than putting on all four legs and then trying to slide it the full length through these faux dados, if you will. This gives a little bit of detail on the construction of the top. I essentially glued and screwed the first layer of MDF into the lateral, into the framework. And then I glued on the second layer of MDF, and you can see some of the screws that I shot in from the bottom side from the first layer that had been glued down. I secured the first layer to the 2x4s with, I think it was 2-inch screws, and then I used 1¼-inch decking screws and drywall screws, whatever I had laying around, but they were 1¼-inch length to hold the two pieces together. This was 5/8-inch or 3/4, I think it was 3/4-inch MDF. And here is Ross. You can see after we sort of twisted in the top, or excuse me, the shelf, then we stuck in the other legs on the opposite diagonals here and clamped those in place, and then drilled out the holes through the top rail and bolted those in place. We were just holding the shelf in place with more of these quick release clamps, and you can see here one is already bolted in. He's drilling a hole. I can't tell if that's the pilot hole. I think that's the final 3/8 hole. So moving to the next photo. Yeah, here's Russ again, putting on some finishing touches. Does this photo show it? No. But you can see the foam rubber flooring that I hot glued in place. I used hot glue so that this could be removable. If this ever loses its elasticity or gets torn or too screwed up, you can just pry this off, scrape off the hot glue residue, and hot glue on some other ones. Seemed the easiest. This isn't going to get moved around too much, so these should be okay unless it sits in one place for long enough for this to crush and not provide elasticity. Then if you move it to a different uneven spot, they may not have enough give to be able to even it out, so they'd have to be replaced. If you look at this, you can see there's a pretty severe gap here. This is one of the problems of using recycled or reclaimed lumber. It tends to be pretty bowed and cupped. Now I picked some fairly straight pieces for these long 66-inch length supports, but even those, I picked the straightest ones for the top. Since that was the most critical part. The shelf just has to be strong. This one, you can tell, is actually twisted quite badly. And even though I clamped the crap out of these and then shot the screws in and let the glue dry, this one still didn't bond right. And I couldn't tighten the clamp enough to twist it back into shape. So the next day, the problem is, because of that twist, it wasn't going to fit into the space between the two dados on the opposite legs on this end. It was going to force the legs to splay out. And rather than try to, you know, crush things together with the bolts and fight it, I took the entire shelf, and I think, yeah, actually I had already glued and screwed the OSB decking of the shelf in place. I took out all the screws on this long runner here at every joint, and what I did is I ran that through my table saw and shaved off, since the top of the shelf was relatively square, I went ahead and shaved this off on my table saw, took off maybe 1/8 inch. It was very important to take the screws out because they weren't countersunk in far enough to me feel safe running them through. I would have torn up my blade. And when I ran this through and then flipped it, I only cut half the height. Then I flipped it end for end and ran it through again. And in flipping it, this joint actually did come loose on me again. That's how badly twisted this was. But having shaved it down, I then had sufficient, I cut down the width of the overall shelf enough to fit in that space. So I put the screws back in, I threw some more glue on this joint after scraping off the old glue, put the screws back in here, clamped the crap out of it, and I let that dry overnight before delivering this to him. But yeah, those are the kinds of things you get into when you're dealing with recycled lumber that you just sometimes have to find a workaround. And here is the man himself. I made him pose for a photo. He's pretty camera shy, but I knew his wife would want one. And you can see Ross is about 6 foot tall. You can see I made the back riser tool board slightly taller than he is, but not too short and not too tall. You want to be able to easily reach across that 24 inch width of the bench and get in the shot. You can also see the trim I put on the sides. That is just a 2x4 that I laid down on a table saw and ripped 3/4 inch thick pieces off of. Yeah, it's 1.5 inches tall. And one of the tricky parts actually was trying to how do I want to say this? I hadn't measured or made any plans for this, and I didn't want to sacrifice another long board for it. So I don't know if you can see this here. Let me zoom. Right at the left edge there, there's a seam. And that's where there's the front trim actually constitutes two parts. And I didn't want to sacrifice another long 2x4 for this. This was one I just had kind of laying around and decided to use it and just created a butt joint there. The rest of the corners are actually mitered. I was practicing my joinery. And these are glued in place and then nailed with, I think it's 1.5 inch brads. And you can see how it bolted together. I just did one bolt at each junction. There's no specific gussets in place to prevent racking, but because these dados and this rabbet joint essentially is very tight, it's kind of self-gusseting, if you will. So there's very little rack to the bench. You'd have to really horse on it to even rack it at all. If necessary, you can add some triangular gussets here at the back. Put a plate or a brace on there. This also shows the upright from the rear. And this one was really simple too. I took another 2x4. It's 48 inches across. And I had a sheet of this perf board laying around. So it's 48 inches across, and I cut the uprights at 36 inches total length. But yeah, these uprights are 36 inches, and I just glued and screwed a single nail, pre-drilled, but ran a single nail, or screw in there. And then these are ripped from a 2x4. I just took a 2x4 and ripped it in half. It was 48 inches long. And then the 36 incher, I ripped it in half and use that as this brace. And you can see there's a single screw here that is pre-drilled and countersunk, and this joint is glued as well, and there's same on the other side. And this helps prevent twisting or racking of the tool board upright. And the way it works is there's the 3/8 inch bolt that runs into the top frame, and then these are glued and screwed. And then if you look here in the center, there is a deeply countersunk 2.5 or 3 inch screw that shoots down through the MDF top and into the 2x4 frame. I think this was actually a 3 or 3.5 inch screw. I wanted to get it down into something other than MDF. But this actually worked out very well. I was a little dubious at first because I was kind of just making it up as I went, but you can grab the top of this and horse it back and forth, and it'll actually tip the bench. It does not rack at all. This ended up being some pretty decent joinery. But I'm happy with how that came out. And actually, Ross was too. As a civil engineer, he thought it was okay. So If a civil engineer gives it the okay, then I guess I did good. Just another shot of the bench, and you can see the top is just hardboard. I screwed up a little bit. I think I bought 1/8 inch hardboard instead of the 3/16, because you can see there's about a 1/16 inch reveal roughly on this trim. And I had a little bit of trouble keeping the trim straight because, again, I cut it out of a pretty nasty looking 2x4 and just sort of forced it to be as straight as possible for trim using the brad nails until the glue set. But the hardboard top is just nailed in place with some 3/4 inch brads, so when this gets all boogered up, you can just tear it up and rip out the brad nails with a pair of pliers and cut and put down a new piece of hardboard. Here it is in use in his garage and already holding stuff, so he's very happy with it, said he would be using it a couple times a week, was beside himself actually because he's needed a workbench for a while, so it made a pretty good present. If you have any questions, you can leave them in the comments. Unfortunately, I don't have any real plans for this, but it should be pretty straightforward. It mirrors the design of my bench, it's just not as lengthy, and only has 4 legs, which is a lot easier to level. So thank you for watching, I hope you enjoyed it, and I'll see you again soon.